Welcome back to the Kilowatt Challenge, and a big shout out to everybody who's joined us recently as a result of my prank I pulled on Pete at Homebrew Powerwalls with the bomb. Dun 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 dun! Now stay tuned for plenty more of that kind of silly stuff. And also, you'd be interested to know that I did a behind the scenes video, not only of the journey there, but also how it was all filmed and a bit of a chat and interview with Pete as well. That's going to be coming out in about, two or three weeks or something, but let's join the journey where I'm at so far. So, what's the intro? Let's have an intro. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Kilowatt Challenge, and in today's episode there'll be some of this.
I've got a lot to learn, haven't I?
There'll be one of these.
Oh shit.
Oh, that did hurt. And there'll be lots of this.
God, what am I doing? What am I doing?
But before all that, so in the last video, I made the decision to develop everything I needed to be able to run this house off-grid for 24 hours. And that is the challenge, the Kilowatt Challenge. But I need a plan. What's the plan, Darren?
So I'm at the absolute beginning of the project. The absolute beginning. I've been dabbling with batteries and I bought some solar panels, just a few old second-hand ones. A cheap inverter, and I'm learning. I've bought 6 batteries, laptop batteries, and I've managed to pick up one or two for free, just with work and stuff, you know. And I'm particularly interested in this concept of a power wall. A Tesla sell a power wall, and inside there are, well, thousands of 18650 batteries. And again, the idea is the energy which you produce from the sun first powers the appliances in your house. It then, and obviously you can change settings, it then charges the batteries on the power wall. And then, finally, when the batteries are full, that's your energy that you're going to use in the evening, you then export to the grid and sell the excess power. The idea being, when the sun goes down in the evening, you've saved energy in the batteries. So you can continue to run from the energy which you've created during the day by using the batteries. But, God, you need a lot. I mean, loads and loads of batteries. Thousands, in fact. Where do you get thousands of batteries used? Where do you buy broken laptop batteries? This is being a problem. I've started sending some emails out. I've started doing some inquiries. It's not easy. It's not easy. So the next thing is the inverter and a charge controller and, you know, the bit that makes the magic happen. The bit that connects to the solar panels and the batteries. How many options are there out there? There is so many to choose from. But I've got something which is slightly different to most houses. My house is three-phase electric. Three-phase. So I've either got to buy three single-phase inverters, or I need to buy a mega big one, which means mega expensive, which means Darren's mega unhappy. But there's one or two which I've been looking at. Daniel from DIY Tech and Repairs has got a big green MPP solar converter regulator. I've got a lot to learn, haven't I? And it's cheap, it works, but when it's idle it consumes 7 kilowatt hours per day. I mean, that's a lot. Think about what that costs. Okay, in the summertime, you're going to be producing a lot of power with that. And in the summertime, you're going to make a profit. You're going to have the electric company paying you the feed-in tariff. But in the winter, that's just going to drain your batteries. It's just going to kill all of the power that you've managed to generate and save. It's going to consume it all. So there's a Victron inverter which is 3 times more, but I don't know what the consumption of that is. I don't know what the model number is. I've been reading yesterday. Oh God, talk about spending a lot of time and money on something. So, yeah, the inverter charge controller regulator thing, minefield. So another thing I've got to consider as well is the voltage of the battery array which I'm going to build. 12 volts, like car battery style. 24 volts, like truck battery style. But the bigger systems seem to be all set up for 48 volts, which makes sense. I understand that. Carrying a lot more power, so you need to have slightly more voltage, more efficient. Cable diameters are a lot more sensible, a lot more affordable. So I get that. So I'm pretty confident at this early stage I'm going to go 48 volts. Pretty confident. God, what am I doing? What am I doing? And in terms of solar panels, is it not just the more the better? I've got a pretty big roof. I can probably get a few on there. My house is not exactly south facing, but it is southwest east facing. That doesn't make sense. If you imagine the corner of it is like that, so I should get the sun, being in a northern hemisphere, I should get the sun to the south for a long time. So I don't think I'll ever hit peak power. The panels will never be running at full tilt, but I'll catch the morning sun and I'll certainly get the evening sun as well. Where do you buy panels? How do you buy them? How do you install them? How do you put panels on the roof? Those rails, where do you buy those rails? What are they called? Voltage, have like 900 volts you're dealing with. Oh, it's scary, isn't it? I'm gonna need a man or a woman who knows what they're doing. I'm gonna need a company to give me some advice on that. Heating systems. Wow, I mean, that's endless in terms of possibilities. The obvious one, especially living in Scandinavia, is to get a ground source heat pump. But I've got a couple of friends who work with those, and you're talking $20,000 US, $25,000 US. It's a little bit out of my budget, slightly out of my reach. I've got to think of something better. At the moment, the house has no central heating system. Every room is just heated either by the radiators, the electric radiators, or by the air source heat pump. So I've been looking at taking the log burners out, and I've been looking at an electric heating system which has connected to a series of radiators. But again, I'm worried about the energy that we're going to need to be able to power that. What I have found is, if I'm going to take the log burners out, why can't we have a log burner or something like that, a combustible thing, which can heat water and then pump it around the house? Surely that exists. Well, in fact, I found a good one. I found a company in the UK that sells log burners, which have got integrated water heaters specifically designed for central heating. And they're not too expensive. They're certainly not $20,000. About $1,000 US, I can get a 30 kilowatt log burner. Now, wood, as you can see, is plentiful in Sweden. It doesn't cost very much, and it's certainly renewable. Not the best in terms of emissions, but for now, my thoughts are, if I install radiators into every room, and then put one of these super uber mega #.com log burners in, which can heat everything, and install a 100 watt central heating pump, that should heat my house for not very much money at all. Then we can turn off, nearly spoke Swedish then, sorry. Then we can turn off the underfloor heating, we can turn off the electric radiators, we can turn off the air source heat pumps, and then we can heat the house using only the wood and the 100 watt central heating pump. That's going to go a long way to reduce our energy consumption, for sure. So the big question just now is, where do we start? It's December 2019. I've got a lot to do, obviously. And because the electricity bill is the biggest pain in my ass, I need to start with electric, don't I? So I'm going to start building the power wall. And that fits and feels quite logical, really, because I've already got some batteries and I've already been playing, and obviously the research I've done so far will all count towards that. So, anybody got 2,800 laptop batteries cells for sale? Oh God, what am I doing? What am I doing? Anyway, ramble over. So you add all that up, and there's a lot to do. An awful lot to do. I need to be careful with the expense of all this as well. Obviously the object of the exercise is to save money. Oh, oh shit. That's right, Darren. Try filming while walking in the forest. Yeah, and I'm going to try and be transparent with the cost. Well, I am going to be transparent with the cost. That's going to be important because I want to share this. If you guys are going to have a go as well, you're going to want to know the ins and outs of it and what it all costs and how it all works, and that's all part of the fun, isn't it? So there we have it. Back to the man cave.
So stay tuned and join me on the next episode where I drive to the other side of Sweden to pick up loads of these e-bike batteries, each one containing 40 to 50 cells. That's in the next episode. So in the meantime, why don't you give me one of those? We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.